Hello everyone, I hope you're having a great day. This is Story Dive, back again, breaking down another episode of American Gods. This time, Season 2, Episode 4, titled The Greatest Story Ever Told. My general thoughts on this episode are that it was probably my least favorite episode of Season 2 so far, which is not to say that it was bad, because all the episodes have been very good. But it was a slower episode, and nothing hugely dramatic happens until near the end of the episode, when something fairly important happens, but we'll get to that later. Like last time, I'm going to go over the entire episode, break down all the Easter eggs and references I noticed, and give my commentary and thoughts on the story and where I think it's going. And if you haven't seen the episode yet, there will be spoilers at this point in the video. So, let's get started. The episode starts with this young boy, who is never named, but in the credits he's referred to as the CEO when he's older. The episode begins with this young CEO playing one of the earliest video games, perhaps the earliest PC game, Pong, so we can assume this is the 70s, and right around the origins of the home PC or home computer. But his father forces him to do his piano practice, which he isn't quite as absorbed in. Later, the CEO as a teenager is playing a Game Boy, which is a fitting name because the CEO is in a way related to Tech Boy, and he's playing a Game Boy, a very similar name. He's also listening to Faith No More, which was one of my favorite bands as a kid. But his father comes by and forces him to listen to Bach, which his father then refers to as the way he prays. So there's an interesting dichotomy between the music of Faith No More and Bach as a kind of prayer. As the CEO is college age, he develops software which is able to analyze and recreate the style of Bach. In creating this program, the CEO had to unleash the code.
They gave it permission to shatter the rules.
And as we find out at the father's funeral, this unleashes Tech Boy. So this future CEO is essentially the father of Tech Boy. He is Tech Boy's first believer. And an idea I had while watching this is that perhaps Tech Boy looks the way he does because the CEO envisions him as a young Bach with hipster fashions. In the last episode, Mr. Wednesday said that Shadow would wake up and feel like $1 million, and we see why. It's because during the night he's visited by the Egyptian goddess Bast, the protector and warrior associated with cats, and we get this fairly long, detailed sex scene here where she displays many cat-like characteristics and probably uses her godly powers to help heal and rejuvenate Shadow. When Shadow wakes up, we see the goddess that was in his bed during the night, only in her animal form. That sick bastard. Shadow suspects it was a dream, but the feline scratch marks are still all over his body. Shadow visits Mr. Ibis, who is performing a very difficult to watch embalming or death rites on this woman. Mr. Ibis explains how he and the other Egyptian gods established the funeral parlor in Cairo, and Shadow points out that it's appropriate they went to a place called Cairo, but then Mr. Ibis replies,
Chicken egg.
Implying that the city is named Cairo because of the Egyptian gods in it. They came first. Mr. Ibis tells Shadow that Laura has joined Matt Sweeney, I suspect in New Orleans, but Ibis won't give away the location. Wednesday enlists Shadow to go with him to St. Louis, where they will meet the god of money. Wednesday only refers to the god as money.
Money, the most influential god in America.
And doesn't give us any insight into what potential older god this is, if it is an older god. In the novel, there was a god associated with money who is referred to as the man in the charcoal suit, but Neil Gaiman never reveals who it is, leaving it up to us to speculate. In one of my videos about American gods, I speculated that this god may be the Roman god Mercury, who is a patron god of wealth and commerce. But I also heard some great theories, like perhaps it is Mammon, the literal personification of money that originated in the Bible, but was later depicted as a personification of wealth and greed. These are both theories, and unfortunately, the identity of this god is not fully revealed in this episode. I hope it will be in future episodes, but we'll get more into that later. Bilquis goes into this chapel and has an interaction with Ruby Goodchild, the daughter of the woman being worked on by Mr. Ibis. Ruby says,
Reverend Hutchins says that all things are a matter of ideas, and God is just one idea.
And Bilquist points out that the Reverend is quoting Beneatha from A Raisin in the Sun, a 1959 play by Lorraine Vivian Hansberry. Mr. Nancy comes in, and in this interaction between him and Bilquist, we can see that he suspects her of fraternizing with the new gods. He says she's crisscrossing across the battlefield. Back at the bunker, there's an interaction between Tech Boy and New Media. New Media describes that she can still feel the old media inside her, but we can see that Tech Boy is pretty unhappy with this new media. I don't think Tech Boy really likes anybody, but he respected the old media more. Then Mr. World comes in, very upset about what happened with Argus. But Tech Boy says not to worry, there's a guy in Silicon Valley who can give them an upgrade. The guy we met at the beginning of the episode. We get another one of these map effects, which I love. There's the little figurine of Paul Bunyan. And the shot pulls out to reveal that they're in a diner in a Motel America in Missouri. And this map is actually in the center of the diner. We see it through the rest of the episode. I'm not sure if all the Motel Americas have this map. At the very least, there's one in this Missouri branch. Mr. Wednesday refers to the title of the episode, The Greatest Story Ever Told, which is a 1965 film about Jesus of Nazareth. But in this case, Wednesday explains that the greatest story ever told is money, because money is simply a story. And we find out that Mama G is a waitress in pretty much every Motel America. When I first saw her working as a waitress and a maid, I thought she had fallen on hard times, but Wednesday reveals that she owns all of these Motel Americas, but despite that, she and her followers, perhaps other Hindu gods, do all the work in them. Mama G says victory is sweet on the tongue, referring to the outstretched bloody tongue of Kali, the way she's usually depicted. And Wednesday refers to the demon Raktabija.
I recall the day you slew Raktabija.
Who is one of the more prominent demons slain by Kali in Hindu mythology. Whenever Raktabija's blood was spilled, a duplicate of him would appear, but he met his end at the blades of Kali. Tech Boy arrives at the company of his contact in Silicon Valley, and the company building is the shape of the Ouroboros, which is a symbol of a serpent eating its tail that originated in ancient Egypt, later associated with alchemy, that means infinity, and also it's a symbol of death and rebirth, which may be a little foreshadowing of what will happen to Tech Boy later. The company is called Zhai Com, and Zhai is a Chinese surname, so it could be the last name of the CEO, but I also suspect it has a connection to Jian, which is a term in Taoism meaning immortal or enlightened one. And as Tech Boy goes to see the CEO, media is communicating with him through these screens, basically telling him not to screw it up. But Tech Boy is Tech Boy, he has contempt for everything. Tech Boy is reunited with the kid we saw at the beginning of the episode, the CEO, who is essentially his father. Back at Ibis and Jaquel's funeral parlor, we get a nice scene between Mr. Ibis, Bilquist, and Mr. Nancy enters as well. Ibis says Bilquist is as perfect and vibrant as the Euphrates, referring to the longest and most historically important river in Western Asia. Then the cat enters, Bast, and Bilquist refers to her as little sister. And finally, Mr. Nancy enters to rain on their parade. Mr. Nancy refers to the sacred book of Thoth, meaning the sacred book of Mr. Ibis. And actually, I'll go with Mr. Nancy's pronunciation of that from now on, because I've never been sure how to pronounce it. Thoth sounds good to me. And the Book of Thoth he's referring to is a book in fiction and mythology that is said to allow the readers the ability to understand the speech of animals and to perceive the gods themselves. And then Mr. Nancy goes on a bit of a rant, making his case as to why both Bilquist and Mr. Ibis should not remain neutral in this war and should fight.
In the sense that I can tolerate exploitation, oppression, and repression, my worshippers know freedom ain't free.
Because Mr. Nancy is a god of stories, he's always great at making a very convincing pitch and explaining his point of view. He makes a lot of reference to institutionalized racism, historical racism in his speech. At one point he says, only a goddess can adorn the sarcophagus of a god, referring to the Egyptian version of a coffin, the container that would hold the body of the dead in ancient Egypt, at least the royals. Bilquist says she is moved by Mr. Nancy's speech, and she kind of looks like she's trying to seduce him a little bit, but both of these gods seem to have known each other for so long, I think that would be pretty difficult. Back at the Motel America diner, it is revealed that these Girl Scouts, who are referred to as Penny Scouts in the credits, are representatives of the God of Money, but they won't deal with Shadow because they don't have him on their list. You have to have a paper trail to get credit. Back in the chapel, we have another interaction between Bilquis and Ruby, where Bilquis tries to understand Ruby's faith in Christianity, and Ruby explains the reasons she's drawn to it, which I believe a lot of religious people would identify with, which is a sense of purpose, community, comfort. And then Bilquis starts getting into some blasphemous territory. I hope Christians don't get mad at this. Explaining that Jesus was not killed for the sins of humanity, but instead because he wouldn't succumb to the powers that be. But I think Bilquis is actually complimenting him in her own way. Shadow finally confronts Mr. Wednesday about why Wednesday picked him, and Wednesday explains that he needed someone who had nothing to live for, which I don't think anybody really believes, including Shadow. And Shadow says,
I do have value to you. See, I don't know why. You don't want me to know why.
Back at Jai Com, Mr. World shows up and gives the CEO the code he's always wanted, essentially making Tech Boy obsolete. And for a second in the code, you can see a body forming, which I believe might be the formation of a new tech god. And at this point, Tech Boy realizes he's in trouble. He tries to escape, but he is deleted. At least I think he's deleted. I suspect, like media, this version of Tech Boy has been deleted and we will get a new Tech Boy or God of Technology in the coming episodes. I did a little snooping around on IMDb, and the actor Bruce Langley, who plays Technical Boy, is listed as Tech Boy in the coming episodes. So it's possible the same actor will come back and play a different version of Technical Boy, or perhaps he wasn't deleted at all and he's just being controlled in some way. I'd love to hear your theories about that if you have any. As Mr. World is exiting the building, he comes into contact with the Girl Scouts, the representatives of money. They offer him one of their payback bars, and you can see on one of the uniforms, E Pluribus Unum, traditional motto of America, which appears on the Great Seal of the United States, which translates as out of many, one in Latin. And also you can see the Eye of Providence, which is another symbol on the Great Seal and appears on American currency. The symbol is a reference to the all-seeing eye of God. And there are a lot of conspiracy theories related to this symbol and the other Latin phrases on the Great Seal that relate to the idea of the New World Order, something which Mr. World himself represents in this series, I believe. I tried to figure out what these other symbols are, but I'm really not sure. I think they're types of currency or payment types of credit, something like that. Mr. World goes to the diner in the Motel America in Missouri, and we get a second meeting between Mr. World and Mr. Wednesday, where they both make a pitch to the God of Money to essentially get credit for their side. The actor they're interacting with is William Sanderson, who many people will probably remember from Blade Runner, and I'm not sure if he is the God of Money. In the credits, he is called the Bookkeeper, so he could simply be another representative of the God of Money, like the Penny Scouts, who does the books. Or it could be he was just a patron of the diner, but then the god inhabited his body. In the end, the bookkeeper doesn't take sides. He explains,
money doesn't make emotional investments or invest in emotional entities. Too much risk.
And Mr. World seems quite happy with those terms. They go back to the Motel America diner in the real world. Shadow, as usual, looks very confused. And the final shot is the metronome that the CEO was practicing with at the beginning of the episode. And the father stops it, perhaps a reference to the end of Tech Boy. In any case, that is the end of the episode. I'd love to know what you thought of this episode. Did you like it as much as the previous ones? This is episode 4 of 8 episodes in season 2, so we're halfway through already. Where do you think the season is going in the remaining 4 episodes? Let me know if I missed one of the Easter eggs, or if I got something wrong, and I'd love to hear your theories in the comments below. I think in the remaining 4 episodes we'll have some pretty big reveals, and it should be very interesting. Please come back and join me for season 2 episode 5 next week. It should be a good one. I did some snooping on IMDb, and I'll just say that part of it takes place in New Orleans. I can't wait to see that part. If you like this video, please give it a like and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. And if you want more, check out these other videos about American gods. Thanks for watching. Until the next episode of American Gods.